It's a 1994 Chevy G20 van, V8.
Call it the Chevrolet Minivan Falcon.
Yeah, the Chevrolet Minivan Falcon. It is the highest paid band member in the group. Treats us well.
Treats us great, yeah.
Little TV.
Usually doesn't act up.
The air conditioning's not working right now, but it will soon.
And it's the reason it's not working is because we fixed it.
Yeah, honestly.
It's the kind of thing that when it stops working, I want to like permanently install it somewhere, because there's just been like every memory of my life that's been pretty good has been going on in here for the past couple years.
Yeah, we've probably done like 30,000-40,000 miles.
That's almost 70,000 miles since we bought it.
There you go.
Closer to 60, I should say, but it's, you know, in 2.5 years of touring.
What's the furthest away place you've played?
It's not that. I mean, we've just been going West Coast a lot.
What's farther? Like Chicago.
Yeah, I mean, I guess in Colorado, we're just like LA. We're like the same distance.
Seattle might be the farthest.
West side, yeah, Seattle.
It's like the corners, so Seattle, LA, Austin, Chicago. Yeah. We've done like that chunk of the US.
But we've been doing it a lot. It's gotten to the point where we go back to cities and our friends, I guess, now we'll see it and be like, you still have that?
Floral.
school, in fourth grade, they kind of had like requirements in school for a band, and I started playing trumpet, and then, this is back in elementary school, and then in middle school I played the tuba, and Connor played the baritone.
Same section.
So we sat next to each other in middle school doing that, and then...
Stuffing shoes into tuba bells.
Yeah, it was like, I mean, it was middle school band in a town that was like football and like skiing, so I think guitar, Connor started before me, and I never really like started to play guitar to learn how to. I just like never really learned. I just kind of figured out how to play that better than I was learning how to play. I don't know. Yeah. So, and I had this like Stratocaster that was my first guitar, and then I left it in Denver before a tour once. So I just had to borrow guitars every show. And the last show I used a Rickenbacker, and I was like, I should get one. And then a couple months ago, I just got another one. I'm not rich. I'm not rich at all. Poor.
I actually grew up playing guitar, like I was saying. And I really first got into synths. And then as I started playing synths more, I figured I should become a better keyboardist. So I've been doing that for like 4 or 5 years now. And it's kind of been a one instrument in, one instrument out. I don't play a ton of guitar anymore. I grew up playing with my dad, and we would play like the same songs that we now play together. Like the exact same songs, maybe like a few more Beatles songs, but I don't know, the vibe was just natural. It wasn't like, there was never like a concentrated conversation about this, like we're going for this. It was just put four people in a room with instruments, and
yeah,
something
and
will come
happened
out.
To be there.
Oh yeah, it was Collins Rhodes first.
Oh, is that right?
Yeah.
I just gotten it from some guy on Craigslist like forever ago, and then started playing with somebody who was exponentially better at keyboard than me. So now he owns it.
My pedal board used to be Collins' pedal board too.
Collins had most of the equipment.
I need a lot of gear. I found Nick's drum set for him too.
Oh yeah.
And I'm using your snare too.
Yeah.
Sorry, everyone asked. Where'd you come up with your drumming style?
Oh man.
I started long.
Yeah, you probably all play drums. Yeah.
Blues, yeah. Baby, Memphis.
I picked up drums in middle school and just kind of taught myself for the majority of my, I don't know, youth. And then took some lessons when we all met in college. But yeah, I don't know, just mostly I learned drums just by like sitting and playing the songs I was listening to on headphones and trying to play those drum parts. So a lot of things, a lot of Led Zeppelin too, of course.
Wasn't it first on an electronic kit?
No. It was on a Toys R Us kit.
Red Rocks premieres will continue.
Denver is home to some of the country's best places for concerts, theaters, and events. We're also home to a vibrant arts and cultural scene. That's Arts and Venues Denver. Red Rocks Amphitheater. That's Arts and Venues Denver. The Performing Arts Complex. That's Arts and Venues Denver. The Convention Center, Coliseum, and McNichols Civic Center. That's Arts and Venues Denver. Look around at Denver's array of public art. That's Arts and Venues Denver, too, guiding and maintaining the city's distinguished display. And it's also diverse cultural programs, such as One Book, One Denver, Film Fiesta, and the Five Points Jazz Festival. Arts and Venues Denver aims to amplify our quality of life and enrich our city's vibrancy and culture. Arts and Venues Denver, a dynamic city agency serving you.
Thank you.
the iconic.
Going to shows here since like mid end of like before I was in high school.
And
I don't know. It's always just like a nice special kind of thing. Every time someone's in Denver, it's like, oh, where do you go? I'm like, oh, go check out Red Rocks. And I don't know. I was like really appreciative of the Denver Film Society to let us do this. And I know we're all trying to work really hard just to progress our band as like an individual. Hopefully can come back here.
I mean, it's a pretty great opportunity. You can't really turn down playing the most historic venue in your state.
Yeah.
Let alone probably one of the most notorious in the nation, at the very least. So.
It's pretty terrifying.
Yeah.
No, I'm excited. No, I'm not. Keep saying that. It's not scary.
It's cool, fun, man.
It's cool.
I'll find out, yeah.
So what's terrifying for you, to be honest? I appreciate it.
You've done it.
Once you get out there, you'll be fine, but what's it feel like right now?
Just looking at a lot of empty seats and then just imagining them full.
I like a lot of the venues we play at specifically. It's like you have one tier, or then you look up and you have a second tier, and then it's like looking up here, and it's like it doesn't, stop.
I like that.
And it'll definitely
more people like. I don't consider it scared. I hate roller coasters because I'm scared of roller coasters. I hate that feeling. But when I see a bunch of stuff and I get that scared feeling with this, that's my roller coaster. It's kind of like.
I mean, I'm sure.
Yeah.
One of those things.
Right.
Once
on,
you start
brother.
Playing music, you're just doing exactly what we always do. Definitely, maybe a little more nerve-wracking or not, but usually we just kind of zone in with each other and just play the music the way we wrote it.
Yeah.
At
I'd
least the goal.
If I had to go do karaoke up there right now, I'd be scared.
Yeah.
So that's what scared is. I went here with a friend. And we went and saw Ryan Adams and Kurt Vile. And my buddy got us passes, so we like walked in through here. And at the time, my hair was all Ryan Adams-y, and I had like a denim jacket on, and my friend was kind of all Kurt Vile-y. And we had to catch like a ride, so we're sprinting out of here running, and there's like an old guy being like, hey, good show. It's like, that was not us. Clearly, it's not us.
Thanks, guys. We got two more for you.
Guys, we're Flaural from Denver, Colorado. We got one more for you, and then Grand Budapest Hotel. Thanks for listening.
All the things.
Thanks so much, guys. We're Flaural from Denver, Colorado. Thank you, Denver Film Society. Thank all of you for listening.